Hey guys, what's up? Will here. It's what morning is it? Monday morning? Woke up this morning and looked at my notifications, emails, that kind of stuff. And boy, I'm pretty disappointed at what I saw. Someone commented on one of my videos. I made a video. It was a question for Rob Skiba. And someone responded saying that, they looked at his website and seems he's taking down, I think his website's like testingtheglobe.com. Someone said he took down all of his information, all of his videos, and he put a statement up saying that he wished he never got into this flat earth thing. Wow. So I was curious. I was like, well, maybe Rob found something. You know, maybe he found this thing that told him that this flat earth thing was a total sham, right? That maybe there was that one piece of evidence that said, oh, look, it's 100% a globe. And so perhaps he felt a little dissuaded, you know? Perhaps he felt a little deceived with this flat earth thing. That's what I was expecting, right? So I went to his website, read what he was saying, and boy, the opposite is really true. Wasn't really stopping because of any, I mean, this is just my opinion of it. He didn't seem to be stopping talking about flat earth because of any truth behind it, or he found out that it was wrong or anything like that. Actually, I think just the opposite. He stopped because he said it was taking too much of a toll on his family, on his finances, and the such. He's pretty much done. Basically, he's saying, you know, I don't care anymore. He's done trying to persuade people that all these other people are going to do or are going to call him CIA and a shill and, you know, say that he works for the Illuminati and all this stuff. You can read that statement on any of his pages there. But if you go to his contact page, checked out where it says contact, he puts even more of a description of this. He states that, basically all of his DVD sales that he was, you know, him and his family are kind of living off of, dropped almost nothing. He's just getting a bad name. He's losing the fellowship of his people. And I know for Rob, that's the biggest thing. It's not about being right. It's about the Word of God. And it's about him being able to promote the Word of God and him and his family's well-being. And boy, that was just being hurt. Not that anything was hurting them directly, but these accusations were not healthy. He's losing people out of his church, just being called a bunch of names. I'm sure it has a backlash on his family also, I would not doubt. Don't know what else is really happening, but he made a statement about, well, Satan, you've won. So all these people who are out there accusing him and making these statements, and you really don't have a clue, you know, the truth is going to come out. So Rob still says that he thinks the truth, everything's going to go down in September anyways. So, you know, he's still there. He's still on the side. I just think he's backing up and saying, you know, no longer going to be a little public figurehead. Because you know what? It's made him too much of a, not a subject of interest, but a target of attacks. He uses the internet to profit, as profit with an F, not with a PH. use the internet to profit, and you know, this flat earth thing has just been, even though he significantly believes it, he thinks it's been detrimental to him. So you know, it's kind of a shame. I really wish this didn't happen, but it did. So it looks like Rob's out, and I just think that's ooh, it smells good. I just think that really shows, you know, if you're out here and you're looking to put out these truths, one, this shows the amount of indoctrination of people. So much that these people are going to make accusations against you just for believing differently than them. I do think that there will be some of the people who are making the accusations who are biased or agendicized, have an agenda to try and suppress this truth, disinfo, discredit agents, whatever you want to call it. I just think that if you read Rob's little breakdown there, it's pretty much a great, that's pretty much a great definition of what all of us flat earth proponents, us supporters of this notion, us truthers, it's what we run in. It's what we run in conversations to people, man. I mean, you know, even just talking to someone about this, the looks that you get and the loss of, you know, people that have previously been your friends and had confidence in you, that loss of confidence, that loss in, they just think you're crazy, you know? So that is what it is. I know that's what it comes with, but people have to know this is not the easiest thing. We do not do this because it's easy, okay? We do this because we think it's true. You know what's easy? It would be easy if we just tout the line, if we just say, hey, you're right, it's a globe, believe NASA, everything's fine, we're back in the matrix. You know, so we've always talked, okay, so let me get into that, the matrix, right? Everybody thinks the matrix is a computer simulation. Possibly this entire world is computerized. That's a little bizarre. I mean, I see this grass, I can feel this grass. I doubt that's a computer. But what if the whole matrix analogy is about computer graphics? You know, are we living in a simulated world because the solar system and the world model is all CGI? When we're in a real world, but everybody's understanding of the world comes from computer graphics. Is that where they keep us in the matrix? They keep us distracted and keep us focused on something else, focused on these lies. Pretty interesting. Now on that line there, people, humans, us, scientists, we've long been interested in space. Okay, what about space? What can we find out from space? What can we hear from space? What can we see from space? You know, just trying to figure out things. That's what we're all about, right? Trying to get these answers. There were these scientists, and they created these large, almost like megaphone kind of things, where they were really microphones. Okay, they look similar to the hearing cones that people would put in their ear, or a an old phonograph, the needle, and then the thing that produces the sound is that cone. Okay, so scientists produced these large. Oh, it's birds this morning. Scientists produce these large cones to listen out into space, and they put them up real high, and they wanted to see what they could hear. They were really confused because they started listening and they started hearing all this noise and started hearing all this static, and they just couldn't figure it out. Well, they started rebuilding them and trying to do better and trying to put all these systems, and no matter what they did, they always kept getting this disturbance in the sound from space. It was kind of this background sound. I don't really know what time these experiments were done. It's been a long time since I've done research on them, but it's definitely interesting because in the modern age, with computers, we were able to take those background noise and actually evaluate them and see if there's any similarities to things that we know. Interestingly enough, turns out this is computer code. They decoded it and they looked and they found it was error correcting code. Okay, so basically error correcting code is in almost every program. Okay, it's in programs that stop the analogous results, the results that do not conform, the results that do not allow mathematical calculations. So let's say if in part of the program you have to take a square root of a number. Well, if somehow before that the variable that you're taking that square root of becomes a negative number, your whole program shut down. You'll get an error. Just won't work. So they have this error correcting code, and what that would do was it would either remove that negative number before it square roots it, or multiply it by a negative so it becomes a positive, because you can't take a square root of a negative. That's just one little mathematical thing that you just that's just one example of the types of error correcting that it did. Okay, I need to find that study again. I think it was on History Channel, but I haven't been able to find it again after I read it a few times. So they now theorize that there's this error correcting code in the universe. You don't think that'll get much publicity, do you? Of course, I keep open the option that that's wrong. It's all, you know, that could be fed to them. Could be completely bogus, because it's not something that you and I can test. It's something that scientists here say that they tested. You know, the majority of other scientists are not able to replicate this. When you take a test that has a high level of technology, you make normal people, normal scientists, normal citizens, unable to replicate the experiment. So that's one thing that's very important with Flat Earth, that there is a disconnect between people who are trying to show replicable experiments and people who are trying to support their opinions with theory that cannot be replicated, theory and hypothetical situations and mathematics that supposedly someone else did. I'm just not really satisfied with that. I think that we need to, that it's my opinion that if this was a globe, it should be very simple to show. Okay, it's my opinion that if the atmosphere is rotating at the speed that it supposedly is with the globe, it should be easy to show. So now let me give you a little brain teaser here for you guys. This comes from a classic problem in science. They call it Schrodinger's cat. It's a kind of a paradox, right? Paradox is something that's paradoxical. You can't define something with a definition. I know. A paradox is something that's a high degree of ironic, where kind of the two things cannot happen at the same time. It's a paradox because it's very unlikely. It's very, it's not very unlikely. It's this unlikely set of circumstances that just kind of come together in something that is very hard to describe. So Schrodinger's cat. Basically, they take a cat, put it in a shoebox. Now, nobody call PETA, please. This is just hypothetical. Put a cat in a shoebox, or in a box, a big box, okay? Cat in a box, and what you do is you have a vial of poison. That poison is, the cap of the poison is, say it's tethered to the top of the box, okay? So the moment, now the question is here. If you're not able to tell that the, let's say you weren't able to hear the cat moving around, purring or anything like that. Let's say the cat could possibly be sedated or something inside there. So you can't hear for scratching or anything. The only way for you to tell if the cat is alive is to open up that box. But the moment you open the box, the cat's dead. The poison comes out, the cat dies automatically. So that's the other part about that, is this. Here's a marmot, guys. Okay. They're like little squirrels. Oh, I think I lost him. I don't know. Well, so back to Schrodinger's, guys. This poison goes instantaneously, okay? So you have this kind of paradoxical state where at that point you don't know if that cat is alive or dead. And there's no way to prove it. Okay, there is absolutely no way to prove if it is alive or dead at that time, because the moment you open it, it's dead. And so that gives you no point of reference. Well, was it alive before that? Of course, the moment you open that lid, you know that cat's dead. But at that point, before that, is that cat dead? Is it alive? It's a paradox. So let me give you another paradox. Let me give you a flat earth paradox. And now these are hypothetical, illogical, almost impossible situations, but they're a kind of a brain teaser, kind of a brain bender, you know, like, well, explain how this would work or explain this. So what my flat earth Schrodinger's is imagine two towers, kind of two poles, impossibly high, right? Miles and miles and miles and miles and miles and miles and miles high. Way up in the atmosphere. Probably, like, let's say, halfway between the Earth and space. It's that high, right? So that, at that speed, the atmosphere is just blazing around. You would not be able to have poles that high. But let's say you have these two poles, and from these two poles, you have a suspended, call it a glass cube. Okay, and this is suspended perfectly. There's absolutely no movement. It's just, now, I know that's impossible. I know the stuff would move. I know there would be flex from the wind and all this stuff. But let's just say you were able to make this immovable, unmovable. Hey, gosh, I'm so tough with that word. I don't know why. Now inside of this glass cube, you put a table. Table's perfectly flat. Okay, perfectly level, perfectly flat. This glass cube is sealed. Now, part of this paradox has to be, there's got to be oxygen for this cat. It's, you know, got to be alive and such. Okay, so let's just say there's oxygen supply, and the cat will be able to survive in this cube, and that's not a question. But we put the Schrodinger's cat in the box on top of the table. It's just sitting there. Now, here's the paradox. Does that cat inside the box, does the box with the cat in it move? And I'm asking you this because of these things. You must think about this. The atmosphere is spinning greatly, okay? And they say the only thing that stops it is gravity. Well, gravity has a diminished effect at that altitude. So at that altitude, would that box be negatively affected? Would there be less of an effect of gravity on that box? Okay. Well, would the atmosphere push that box? No, there's no way, because it's a, you know, glass cube, and, you know, things suspended perfectly and mobile. So no, the atmosphere's not gonna have, okay, there's two of them. The atmosphere's not gonna have any effect on it at all, and that's what we want. So we're looking, what are gonna be the effects of gravity and the rotation? It's my kind of theory that slowly that shoebox with the cat would slide off the table. Why? Because the Earth is spinning so fast, everything is moving so fast, and the gravity is not there 100% to keep it affixed to that point. So I think it would slide. I don't know how long it would slide. Of course, that depends on the height of the height of the poles, how much the box weighs, and how much gravity is actually diminished during that time. But I think the box would move. Of course, we all know if we had a box suspended that high and there was no glass cube, it would fly right off the table because of the atmosphere. I mean, it's rotating at huge speeds. I mean, it's rotating at so much faster than ground level, because the further you get away from a circle, you have to rotate faster to keep up. Smaller circle rotating would be slower than a larger circle rotating if you have a small circle and a large circle with the same central point, and that central point is rotating, then the further you go out from the central point, the faster it would be rotating. Well, I don't really think there's an answer for the Schrodinger's. I want to say that it probably would not move, in my opinion, because it's flat. But I definitely do think that if it was on a globe model, it would move. And it would move, you know, it couldn't be from the atmosphere. And I just think that's another paradox. I just think it's kind of an impossible. And, you know, like, okay, so there's these people. Let me just say, this is the last part of this today. These people suggest experiments. And so, you know, we're looking for ways to prove this. We want to have these easy experiments, and we want to prove this, and we want to do these experiments. But then there's people that propose, hey, you know what you need to do? You need to do this experiment, and, you know, go do this XYZ, and, you know, go down here and look at this. You know, my problem with the majority of these experiments that people propose is that they are, one, a lot of them aren't going to prove anything. Two, they're expensive, and three, they're timely. Come on, guys, you really expect me to fly over the Antarctic in an airplane? Seriously, why don't you do that? I mean, come on, the stupidest suggestions come from the people who think they're making up these experiments to support the globe model. Like, there's a friend of mine who, I knew him from the Army, and he kept telling me, you know, because I went to Facebook, okay, and I said, look, y'all who are interested, y'all who absolutely believe this globe model, well, guess what? I'll bet you. Yeah. I said, I'll bet you. Long-term bet. Bet you in the next 5 years that the globe model will be shattered. You know? And I'm not saying how this will be done, but I'm just saying, you know, for the most part of society, it's, the truth's going to be out there within 5 years. Firmly believe that. Now, nobody took me up on the bet. One of my friends, this guy was talking about, he suggested, he said, I've got a proposal for you. You fly from, you know, he was saying like California to the East Coast to Asia to whatever, you know, and his idea was that, oh, look, you can fly east to west and you end up right back where you were. We end up right back in California. Hello? I told you, doesn't prove anything. You can fly east-west on the flat earth model. So people who give suggestions like this just show how little they actually are paying attention. Okay? Show how little they've really done the research on the flat model. You can't design an experiment where what you're doing would be supported by both sides. It doesn't show anything. It doesn't prove anything. It's absolutely ridiculous. So, you know, these people who are making these suggestions, it just shows how little,
hey, there, here he is.
Hey, leave the door open for me. Just shows how little they've really researched on the fact. So, all right, guys, appreciate you. Take care. And, I'm definitely sorry about Rob. Definitely sorry about Rob, and can't say that I didn't expect it. I don't think I expected it this soon. It's only been a couple months. He hasn't been in this for 3-4 months, and look at how much of a negative effect it has on him. So, I'm not saying don't research this. I'm not saying you need to stop or anything like that. But look at Rob. I don't know if there's something we can do. Somehow we can pull him back into this. I definitely hope that Rob finds within himself the fortitude to combat Satan. I know that's probably going to be the most difficult thing for him financially. But is there a least important thing? I mean, on his own website, he said, you know, congratulations, Satan, you won. I hope Rob comes out of this funk. I hope he decides not to give in, not to let up. I mean, you know, they did say that the Christians will be persecuted. What if the true Christians are persecuted not by floggings, flails, torture, but by financial ruin, but by being called names, by the lack of credibility, the loss of credibility. What if we're looking at a different persecution now than we really ever have been in the past, than we ever have in the past? You know, I think when we're dealing with this, if this is a great deception, and I know that's one thing that Rob kind of thought too, is that, you know, it's a possibility this is the great deception. Well, if this is the great deception, I think that we've just had a minor loss, definitely. Loss of a friend, and not a friend, loss of a colleague. Loss of someone who I enjoyed his evaluation of things. Might not have agreed 100%, but that's not what it's about. It's about other people taking looks at things and saying, huh, you know what? That's a good point. Never thought of that before. So I hope that he finds the strength within himself, that somehow God brings him back into this, because although I know that it's difficult for him, difficult for his family, that we need every person out there, because how many people have you touched? How many people have you opened their eyes? How many people have you got looking at things a little more? Say you've already made a difference, and hope you come back. God bless. Peace, love, my friends. Thanks.